I want to focus on a particular kind of knowledge that I think we all have that's kind of tricky, it's difficult to characterize. And I'm going to discuss where that knowledge comes from and what it's like, what its nature is. So everyone here knows all sorts of things. So you know some history and some science and some math. Maybe now you even know some philosophy. You also know some non-academic things as well. You know about your friends and your family. You know about your past. For example, you know probably what you had for breakfast this morning or where you came from. You also know a lot about your immediate environment. You know you're sitting in a room here, listening to me talk. You're sitting at, in a chair. Maybe you've got a notepad you're aware of. You know all of these things about your immediate environment. Some of this knowledge is pretty easy to characterize in terms of what it is that you know. So for example, you probably, I assume, know that 2 + 2 = 4. I assume that you know that. It's pretty easy to characterize what you know in that case. I just said it, you know, 2 + 2 = 4, exactly that. But some other bits of your knowledge are a little bit tougher to characterize in terms of what it is that you know. So take, for example, the first time that you tasted a raspberry. Try to imagine that, first time you tasted a raspberry. When you tasted that raspberry for the first time, you learned something new. You learned what a raspberry tastes. And that might seem straightforward, but when you really try to flesh out and characterize what exactly does that knowledge consist in, what is all that knowledge there, it becomes a little bit more difficult. You might say, well, I learned that raspberries are sweet, a little tart, maybe fresh tasting, maybe you like it. But it seems like no matter how much description you give, how many details you go into, you're not really characterizing or exhausting what you know there. If, say, I had never had a raspberry, and you were trying to tell me what a raspberry tastes like, it seems like you could go on and on and on, and still I wouldn't be able to grasp what you grasp or know what you know until I tasted a raspberry for myself. So this is kind of a trickier bit of knowledge to characterize. Take another example. Take your knowledge of your best friend. So think of your best friend and the knowledge that you have of your best friend. Growing up, my best friend was a guy named Kyle. And I could tell you all sorts of things about Kyle. I could tell you he's tall, he has short brown hair, he likes sports, especially baseball and basketball, he's sarcastic, maybe even the humor's a little biting at times. I could tell you all sorts of things about Kyle, but it seems to me at least that no matter how much I told you, I wouldn't be exhausting, I wouldn't be able to communicate to you all that I know about Kyle, my deep personal knowledge of Kyle. So again, this knowledge is kind of tricky to characterize in terms of what is it? What does it all consist in? Notice also, though, that this tricky knowledge is some of the most valuable, important knowledge that we have. It's the knowledge of your best friend, or of your family members, or your fellow students or coworkers. This knowledge is super valuable in itself, but it's also valuable because it's important to how we behave, or how we interact with each other, how we form in groups or societies. To make this point about the value of this knowledge vivid, go back to thinking about your best friend and imagine that your best friend is suffering. Maybe your best friend just lost a loved one and you're there, you're trying to comfort your best friend. It seems that you're in a unique position to comfort your best friend. Why is that? Well, part of it has to do with that knowledge, right? You can read your friend's facial expression better than anyone else. You understand their tone of voice. You know what they're trying to communicate to you. In a way, you can kind of suffer along with them. And maybe you also know how to respond best, what they need to hear and don't need to hear in those circumstances. So again, this kind of knowledge, this tricky knowledge, is some of the most valuable knowledge that we have. So I want to focus on this knowledge a little bit. And what I'm going to do in the next couple of minutes is I'm going to start by introducing a very standard view in philosophy these days about knowledge. And then I'm going to come back to that tricky knowledge and say they don't fit super well with each other, at least not obviously. And then I want to give you a couple of alternative ways of understanding that knowledge. Okay, the standard view in philosophy. Most philosophers these days assume or believe that knowledge requires belief and truth. These aren't the only things maybe that they think knowledge requires, but they think it requires belief and truth. So start with belief. Here the idea is you can't know something if you don't believe it. In order to know something, you have to believe it. So suppose that I buy a lottery ticket, but I don't believe that I'm going to win. Of course I don't believe that I'm going to win. The odds are so far against me, I don't think I'm going to win. But then suppose I do win the lottery. Lucky me, that's nice. But would we say that Matt knew that he was going to win the lottery? No. Why not? I didn't believe it. How can I know something that I don't believe? So again, it seems like in order to know something, you have to believe it. Now for truth, similarly, the idea is that in order to know something, what it is that you believe has to be true. You can't know something that's not true. So suppose I believe that the Earth's flat. Could I know that? No. Why? Because it's not true. The Earth's not flat. How could you know something that's not true? So again, there's this belief, this assumption that knowledge requires belief in truth. And this is connected to what I'm going to call the standard view of philosophy, which is that all knowledge is propositional. There's a kind of exception that has to do with abilities, like your knowledge of how to ride a bike. Set that aside for a second. Except for that kind of knowledge, the standard view is that all knowledge is propositional. Well, what's a proposition? A proposition is just the kind of thing that's true or false. It can be expressed by declarative sentences, so I could say 2 plus 2 equals 4, or it is raining, or it will be raining, or the sky is blue. And that they're by expressed propositions. I can express the same propositions in other ways in different languages, for example. So I could say es regnet, which is German for it is raining, and I've expressed the same proposition. So propositions are the kinds of things that are true or false, expressed by declarative sentences, and they're the kinds of things that we believe. They're the objects of belief. So I believe that the sky is blue. I believe that it is raining. I believe that 2 plus 2 equals 4. Okay, so that's what a proposition is. There might be all sorts of reasons why philosophers think that all knowledge is propositional, but you can see the connection to those earlier assumptions. If you think that knowledge requires belief, and you think the objects of belief are propositions, then naturally you're going to think that all knowledge is propositional. Or similarly, if you think that knowledge requires truth, and you think that propositions are the kinds of things that are true or false, then naturally you're going to think that all knowledge is propositional. Hence the standard view in philosophy. But now let's go back to that tricky knowledge, the taste of the raspberry, or your knowledge of your best friend. This doesn't seem to fit so well with the standard view in philosophy, at least not obviously. So take the taste of the raspberry. We might ask, what set of propositions that I believe corresponds to my knowledge of that raspberry, of that taste of the raspberry? Seems like I give you proposition after proposition after proposition after proposition, and I wouldn't even be on the right track. There's no way I could fully characterize or fully express in that way what I know about the taste of raspberry. Or take the knowledge of your best friend. Similarly, you could ask, what set of propositions that I believe corresponds to my knowledge of Kyle? Again, I could give you proposition after proposition after proposition about Kyle, and it doesn't seem like I'd ever be able to get at or fully account for my knowledge of Kyle. So there seems to be a bit of a mismatch here between the standard view and this tricky kind of knowledge. One philosopher who has sort of realized this or picked up on this in recent years is a philosopher named Eleanor Stump. And she thinks that we need to recognize another kind of knowledge. She calls it Franciscan knowledge. Franciscan knowledge is knowledge, primarily at least, of people. Of ourselves and other people. And it's non-propositional, so it's not constituted by beliefs towards propositions. It's rather constituted by awareness of people and their stories. Stump thinks that we need to recognize this kind of knowledge for all sorts of reasons, but she's particularly interested in those cases I was mentioning earlier about suffering. She thinks that in order to understand other people's suffering and understand how we can respond to that suffering and help comfort people suffering, we need to recognize that there's this other kind of knowledge, Franciscan knowledge, that's non-propositional, that plays a really important role in how we interact with people and their suffering. There's all sorts of things I like about Stump's view. I think it's good in a lot of ways. But notice that for our purposes, it might be a little bit narrow. So it handles the interpersonal case pretty well. But it doesn't obviously apply to the taste of the raspberry. So maybe we need something a little bit broader. Another kind of alternative way to understand this tricky knowledge comes from a philosopher named Bertrand Russell, who was working more in the early 20th century. Russell thought that there were fundamentally two different kinds of knowledge. There's knowledge of truths, which is a kind of propositional sort of knowledge. And then on the other hand, there's knowledge of things, which is non-propositional, of course. So it's not constituted by beliefs towards propositions. It's rather constituted by just awareness of things, of properties and objects around us. There are all sorts of details in Russell's view that some of them are pretty quirky, so I won't go into the details there, but for example, you can just think of ordinary perception. So you see me, you're aware of me, and that in itself counts as knowledge. That's independent of any beliefs that you may form about me. Or take the raspberry case. You taste the raspberry for the first time, you're aware of a certain taste quality. That in itself counts as knowledge of that taste quality, and that's independent of any beliefs towards propositions that you may have about the raspberry or the taste of raspberry. This also seems to at least get us some way toward the interpersonal case. You could think that, hey, some of my knowledge about Kyle is constituted by my awareness of certain of his features, maybe his facial expression or tone of voice or something like this, or maybe some kind of recalled features of his. So it seems that Russell's view or Stump's view do a little bit better in terms of capturing this tricky knowledge than does the standard view, the overwhelming presumption in philosophy today. So let me recap just briefly. I started with that standard view in philosophy, I put it up against that tricky knowledge and said maybe that these don't fit super well together, and then I gave you kind of alternative way of understanding this knowledge. So what's the upshot? Why is this important? Well, insofar as you liked the standard view in philosophy, or maybe you just kind of assumed that that's what knowledge looked like, it's kind of propositional, it's like facts. If that is the way you were thinking, then not only are you going to think that knowledge looks a certain way, but you're probably going to think it comes from certain sources. It's the kind of thing that you can read in the textbook, or hear in a lecture, or read in a science journal. But if Stump and Russell are, for example, are right, then there's this other kind of knowledge that's equally knowledge, but that we need to investigate and understand, and see how it interacts with other sources of knowledge, and how we might reason with it, or make decisions on the basis of it. And furthermore, if I was right in the beginning when I said that this is some of the most valuable knowledge that we have, you might think we have a special imperative to investigate this kind of knowledge, because it might bear not just on what we learn, but also the kinds of decisions we make and how we choose to act and how we choose to live our lives. So this might be a good reason to think a little bit more about knowledge of things.